So we're picking up at verse 5 where we left off. For those who live according to the flesh set their minds on the things of the flesh, but those who live according to the Spirit, the things of the Spirit. For to be carnally minded is death, or to be fleshly minded. That's the same idea of the word there. But to be spiritually minded is life and peace. Because the carnal mind, the fleshly mind, is enmity against God. For it is not subject to the law of God, nor indeed can be. So then those who are in the flesh cannot please God. Quite a dichotomy there, you know, back and forth, either or sort of thing. Now, I want you to imagine this little illustration. Maybe it helps you. Imagine yourself as a two-story house with an underground basement. I know most of our homes in Southern California are built on slabs, but you all know what a basement is. And I'm not talking about those things you see on the TV shows where the basement is like the best room in the house. It's pool table and the big screen TV. I'm talking about that hole in the ground that you don't want to go down into and you don't even like to store stuff down there. The basement. Okay. So three parts. The two stories in the basement, because you and I are three-part beings. We have a body, of course, the physical part of us. But we are spirit beings at our core, our creation. God created us in His image. He is spirit. And we possess a soul. A soul is synonymous with many things that are wrapped up in the idea of a soul, your consciousness. In other words, the non-physical part of you. Your body's your body, but there's more to you than just your body. Your body expresses things like your feelings, your sadness, your joy, and so forth, and your body will express that. The soul is demonstrated through the body in so many ways. Have you ever heard that old expression, the eyes are the window to the soul? I don't know if that's true or not, but I know that I've seen, you know, on TV when they're talking about some evil serial killer, just a total psychopath, and you look in those eyes, and you see the evil, don't you? So often. And so you realize that there's more to us than this, the body. There's also this soul, but we are spirit beings as well. Now, when we're born into this world, of course, as we've discussed many times, our spirit is separated from God because of sin, or it's spiritually dead. And so imagine your spirit down there in the basement. Your soul, your consciousness, your thoughts, your feelings, your focus there on the first floor, and up on the second floor, the things of the body. And that's your life. My focus is my body, my enjoyment, my pleasure. Like Jesus said, what are we going to eat? What are we going to wear today? But when we have the spiritual birth, when we trust Jesus Christ as our Savior, it's as if it flips. Now, still there, that first floor, my mind, my soul, my focus, my consciousness. But now on the second floor are the things of the Spirit. That's what my mind is set on, the things of God, the things of the Spirit. And down there in the basement should be the things of the old sin nature, the flesh. That's not my focus anymore. Now, can I go down there and crawl around a little bit in the basement? Sure I can. But I shouldn't be. I should be focused higher. Now, whether that illustration helps you or not, the point is you see the clear distinctions. And that's what Paul is bringing out here in verses 5 through 8. God divides all of humanity into two groups in various ways in the Bible. Of course, male and female is the first such division we find in the Bible, and the world has completely messed that up. But that's how God sees, what are you, either a male or a female? End of story. Another division came along a little bit later would be Jew and Gentile. You're a Jew, a Israelite, or everybody else, which are all lumped in as Gentiles. But maybe the clearest distinction, and I would say the most important of them all, is you're either a believer in Jesus Christ or you're not. We express that in different ways. You're either saved or you're lost. Notice, not you either go to church or you don't. That's not the issue. But have you had the spiritual birth that Jesus talked about? To a very religious person, by the way, you must have the spiritual birth. Has your house flipped? That's what Paul's talking about, the two groups of people. Those who have had the spiritual birth and those who have not. And that speaks to this issue. Another word that our world has hijacked for its own purposes and made it basically meaningless in many ways. And that's the word identity. You hear the word identity thrown around all sorts of crazy ways today, but it has a biblical idea of this identity in Christ. That's my identity. That's your identity if you're believing in Jesus Christ today. And that's what we have been talking about throughout these prior chapters, because when we believe in Jesus Christ, we are identifying with him. We identify with his crucifixion. We identify with his resurrection. We even have a church ritual that visibly shows that identification, which is really a matter of the heart and of faith, and that is water baptism. We're identifying with his death, identifying with his resurrection in water baptism. So that's the key. And that is the important starting point in wrestling with this issue of living the way that we know we should live. Our starting focus should not be about what we're doing and then what can I do to stop doing the things I'm doing and going back and forth like that. But my starting point has to be who I am in Christ. Because who I am in Christ speaks to what Christ has done for me. And so that is the beginning. That is what is so crucial. Now, having said that about verses 5 through 8, recognize that there are those in the church that would disagree with my take that I just gave you. They would say, Paul's not talking about believer versus unbeliever there. No, he's talking about two types of Christians. And there are those who emphasize the idea of, you know, Christians who are living with a carnal mind, Christians living after the flesh. And the idea, again, is describing someone like Paul was trying to describe himself in chapter 7. They're doing things they know they shouldn't do, and they're not doing the things they know they should do. And so when you look at the verses from that perspective, you know, all they're doing is thinking about the things of the flesh. They've got a carnal mind, and therefore, you know, they're not pleasing God with their lives and so forth. Why I reject that completely, not rejecting the idea that such people exist, of course, but for starters, it certainly gives us a problem with verse 1 where we were told there's no condemnation if you're in Christ. But even more significantly, when we get to the very next verse, verse 9, look what it reads, church. But you are not in the flesh, but in the Spirit, if indeed the Spirit of God dwells in you. Those are the labels. Those are the identifying markers. All this stuff about to have the fleshly mind, to be in the flesh, versus the spiritual mind, to be in the Spirit. It's not about your behavior last night. It's about your identity in Christ. To repeat, you're not in the flesh. That description, that identification doesn't apply to you. No, you're in the Spirit as long as the Spirit of God dwells in you. And then, to really bring home the point, verse 9 ends, now, if anyone does not have the Spirit of Christ, then he, that individual, is not his, is not Christ. When I was in high school and I took chemistry, I learned about a litmus test. And a litmus test was a way in chemistry, you had this solution in front of you. It was probably clear, but you had no idea what was in it. And the litmus test will tell you if this solution is an acid or a base. And there's this special paper called litmus paper. I think litmus is the name of the dye. They treat the paper with this stuff. And you put it in the solution. You just dip it. Even a high school chemistry student can do this. And the paper changes colors. And it'll change one color if it's an acid and one color if it's a base. And that's the litmus test. Now, in our English language, that expression, a litmus test, has come to be applied just in conversation in a lot of different ways, in that sort of either or, yes or no kind of situation, like in politics. There are those who have a certain issue, one particular issue, they say, that's my litmus test. Many Christians say, I will not vote for a candidate who supports abortion. Period. I don't care what party they are. I don't care how important it is for us to hold the Senate this year. Da, 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 da. If they support abortion, I will not vote for them. That is their litmus test. And there are those who hold those convictions. By the way, that works the other time. There's some people, I won't vote for any candidate who doesn't support abortion. You know. There might be other examples in politics. There are other examples in life, but you get the point. Well, the reason I'm talking about that is because this is the litmus test of whether you're a Christian or not. How do I know I'm a Christian? If the Holy Spirit dwells within you, then you're a Christian. And if the Holy Spirit doesn't dwell within you, you're not a Christian. Period. That leads, of course, to another question, doesn't it? How do I know if the Holy Spirit dwells within me? Is there some miracle I do? Is it involved speaking in tongues? Is there something that, you know, that shows itself demonstrably to myself and others in the world? And church, that's why we read from Ephesians 1. I want us to go back there for a moment. Ephesians chapter 1, keep your place in Romans. Paul writing to the church at Ephesus, Ephesians chapter 1. Same passage we read, except I'll skip verse 12 for our purposes now and go straight to verse 13 of chapter 1 of Ephesians. Speaking of Jesus Christ, in him, that's the him, you also trusted. When did I trust him? I'm going to add a few things here along the way, running commentary as it were. In him you also trusted. When did I trust? After you heard the word of truth. Well, the whole Bible is truth, right? God's word is truth. So which word of truth? The gospel of your salvation. That's what particular part of the word of truth we're talking about. The gospel, the good news, which, if we wanted to take the time, we certainly could see easily defined in Scripture in 1 Corinthians, among other places, but 1 Corinthians probably has the clearest. The gospel of salvation is that Jesus died for our sins according to the Scriptures, was buried, and he rose from the dead according to the Scriptures and was seen. A physical death, a physical resurrection, a burial, an eyewitness account. He died for our sins, and he rose from that. That's the gospel. Not just that he died and rose again. He died for our sins. And so, you heard the word of truth, the gospel of your salvation, in whom also you believe. This is what I often call you personalize the cross. You personalize the gospel. Jesus died for the sins of the whole world. Jesus died for my sins. I believe that. That's good news. You believed, And the moment you believe, the instant, the nanosecond that you believe, before you did anything, before you went to your first church service maybe, or certainly before you got baptized, before you did anything, you were sealed with the Holy Spirit of promise. The Holy Spirit of promise, because if you remember, Jesus in the upper room in John's gospel talked about the promise of sending the Holy Spirit after he died, rose, and would ascend. The Holy Spirit of promise. The Holy Spirit, while of course being God, one of the three persons of the triune Godhead, and therefore the Holy Spirit always eternal, the Holy Spirit we see referenced in situations in the Old Testament, but never ever in the same ministry capacity as with the church. The Holy Spirit would come on a guy like Samson or King Saul or someone else in the Bible, and he might leave after a while. He'd come on for a battle, a victory, some sort of a feat. But what Jesus was speaking in the upper room there in the Gospel of John, if you're not really familiar with those verses, get familiar with them. Go read John 13, 14, 15, 16, and 17. Do that this afternoon if you're not familiar with what I'm talking about. But Jesus is telling them on the night of his betrayal, he'll be crucified the next morning. He's saying, I got to go away, because if I don't go away, then the Comforter, as one translation puts it, the Spirit will not come. He will abide with you forever. See, that didn't happen in the Old Testament. The Holy Spirit did not come upon one of God's people forever, but now he does. And it's for all of us, not just when I got to fight a battle or something. And, hey, I need the Holy Spirit today. Can you show up? No, no, no. Remember that, by the way, when you read those Old Testament passages about the Spirit left Saul because of his sin. Well, wait a minute, that's a totally different ministry than what we enjoy. David praying, please don't take your Holy Spirit from me after David was confessing his sin. Don't pray that. God says he's never going to leave us, never going to forsake us. You see? So, back to where we were. You were sealed with the Holy Spirit of promise. A seal, again, first century, Roman Empire context, Greek culture, and all the rest of it. A seal was how you secured, let's say, a document, a letter. You want to write a letter, send it to somebody else, and it's pretty important. Maybe it's your will. You don't want someone tampering with that thing. And so you fold it all up, you close it, and typically using wax, it could also be mud, but something that's kind of, you know, liquidy and fluid, but when it dries up, it gets hardened. You would dip typically some sort of a ring, some instrument into that wax, stick it on your document, and that's sticky, and then it would harden. And now no one is getting in there without breaking it and crumbling it, and everybody knows that it's been tampered with. And they can investigate to see who did it and punish them. Security. Church, you're secure in Jesus Christ. You've been sealed with the Holy Spirit. And the other thing about a seal is this. Especially, again, the important people in Roman society who would use seals, they had their own identification. I mentioned rings. Well, everyone had, you know, you had your own personal image, words, insignia, something on there that identified it for you. Because if I'm a general out there in the field, as I hear, here's a letter came straight from Rome. You better read it. And it opens up and says, I want you to surrender your position. Say, whoa, this doesn't sound like Caesar. Well, yeah, it's a sealed document and everything. It's like, that's not Caesar's seal. This is a forgery. This is a fake. Someone's up to something, you see. So not only is there security, but there's also, there's that word again, identification. You were sealed with God. Your identity is with God now, the moment you believe the gospel. And, as if that wasn't enough, verse 14 continues, speaking of the Holy Spirit, he is the guarantee. Some translations, the idea there, the behind the word, and it's even in the translation, is down payment. Or in the Old King James, it says earnest. Now, that's a word we don't use typically today, but there is this expression, earnest money. If you talk about somebody who says, man, they are really earnest about that, it means they're really serious, right? They're really, you know, eager and into it. They're earnest. Well, earnest money is a way of showing that you are interested in buying something, and it works like a down payment. So let's say there's a yard sale in the neighborhood, and you go to the yard sale, and you got, you know, your bag of quarters or whatever and a couple bucks because it's a yard sale, and then you see something really nice for sale, but the guy wants 50 bucks for it, and it's a good deal, but you didn't bring 50 bucks to the yard sale. So you say, look, I really want to buy that, but I got to go to the ATM and get you some cash. Can you hold it for me? If it was your yard sale, what would you say? Not a chance, pal. No, I really want it. I'll be back. It's like, I don't know you. What if a guy comes and wants to buy it right after you? I tell you what, to show you I'm serious, I do have 10 bucks on me. I know it costs 50, but let me give you this 10. And if I'm not back in an hour, you keep the 10 and you can sell it to anyone who comes by in an hour. But give me an hour. Well, then you say, all right, I'll do that, maybe. Maybe you'll do it. I'm not saying you don't keep your word, but maybe you're not interested in down payments. But for most people, they'd say, all right, yeah, I understand your situation. And so that is called earnest money. It's down payment. It shows you're serious. And that's how the Holy Spirit is described in our lives. God's down payment to show he's serious in the purchase of you. The guarantee of our inheritance until the redemption of the purchased possession to the praise of his glory. It's like we're on layaway while we're down here. Now, I know the younger people are talking about down payments. Now he talks about layaway. What does that have to do with Amazon? I've never bought anything like this in my life. But for us older folks, we know the idea of layaway, and we know the idea of a down payment and all that. We're already bought. We're already owned. God has us, but he hasn't taken full possession yet, has he? We're still down here. But one day he will. How do I know that? I'm not sure. He showed you by giving you the down payment of the Holy Spirit. And that Holy Spirit has sealed you until the day of redemption. You see how it all works together. God could not be more clear than he is in his word. And yes, I skipped over, but I'm coming back to it now. The guarantee of our inheritance. You know, the Bible says that Jesus Christ is the inheritor of all things. That's a big inheritance. And then the Bible says that we are co-inheritors with Christ. We share in what he has earned. He is the faithful and only begotten Son of the Father, God. We, because of our faith in him, are adopted children into the family. And what was true about adoption in first century Rome is also true about adoption in our day as well. And if any of you have familiarity with adoption, as my wife and I do with our son, as most of you know, the judge, before making it official, okay, the adoption is now finalized by, because it is a judge that has to make that call, talked to us very clearly, said, now you need to understand that any biological children you either have now or might have in the future share their inheritance with this adopted child. Are you willing to do that? Absolutely, of course, Judge. All right. That's the thing about being an adopted child. You share in the same inheritance as any of the begotten children. You see why God uses these terms in the Bible? So, going back to Romans 8 now, and going back to that verse, you're either what we could describe by many terms, unsaved, an unbeliever, not a Christian, or in the flesh, or you are saved, a believer, a Christian, a child of God, or in the spirit, if you will. Either or. The litmus test is the Holy Spirit. How do I know I have the Holy Spirit? We just read how. Because you believe the gospel. And that's what God's word says. And God doesn't lie. You know, I think maybe the earliest song that little children learn about Jesus in our households is the Jesus Loves Me song, right? Jesus loves me, this I know, for the Bible tells me so. How do I know this? The Bible tells you so. Is that not good enough for you? How do I know the Holy Spirit dwells in me? Do you believe the gospel? You believe it? Yes. Then he does. Yeah, but I keep living in sin. It's like, well, there you go. That's what Paul's dealing with. That's what he's showing us. And that's where we're continuing on as we go through chapter 8 and beyond, how we can live those victorious lives, again, in the newness of the Holy Spirit, not in the oldness of the letter and the commandments and the do's and the don'ts. So to finish our little section for today, verses 10 and 11, and if Christ is in you, the body's dead because of sin, but the Spirit is life because of righteousness. If the Spirit of him who raised Jesus from the dead dwells in you, he who raised Christ from the dead will also give life to your mortal bodies through his Spirit who dwells in you. Once more, in the context, the idea is not simply the idea, oh, when I die and I go to the grave and they have the funeral, then, you know, I go to heaven. No, in this life, we identify with Jesus' death to sin, alive, identifying with his resurrection to walk in a newness of life. This is who we are. This is what Jesus has accomplished for us. Look at it again. The body's dead because of sin, but the Spirit is life because of righteousness. This is all repetition of what Paul's been saying in other ways in earlier verses. We're now awake unto righteousness in a way that only now is it even possible to even think along those lines. I know how politically incorrect, and some people think that's very insulting there, Pastor, to think along the lines of, if you are not a believer in Jesus Christ, you've not been born again, you cannot please God. Because there's a lot of people that aren't just drooling, you know, hateful atheists out there against all things God. They say, look, man, I believe in God in my own way, and I try to live a good life, and I try to treat people like I want to be treated, and they go on, and there's no doubting that that's probably true. But again, it's not the pastor saying that. It's not some church doctrine saying that. It's what God has said in his word. That's the issue. You cannot please God unless your sins have been forgiven. You see, now in identifying with Jesus' death and resurrection, not only do I have that wonderful hope of heaven, one day God's going to, you know, take possession of me and you, either the rapture of the entire church or that day that he calls each of us home, the end of our lives down here. But see, now, though, I'm not just waiting there because I've been bought. I belong to him. I can now live for him in a way that does please him. through the Holy Spirit. The problem with my little litmus test example that I gave a moment ago is that when it comes to the litmus test in chemistry, it is possible to have a neutral. You know, typically it's either an acid or a base and the color changes accordingly, but it is possible to have a neutral. And that's where my illustration breaks down, because there's no neutrality when it comes to Jesus Christ, is there? That's the issue. That's the politically incorrect statement to make. They say, no, wait a minute, Pastor, I'm not some atheist, and I've got nothing against Christians, and I got nothing against Jesus. I think he was a great man. I think we ought to follow his teachings and all the rest of it. But once more, it isn't a pastor. It is what Jesus himself said, you're either with me or against me. He's the one who said it's an either or. And of course, the proof of which side you're on is the indwelling of the Holy Spirit, as we just said. No neutrality is possible. No fence sitting when it comes to Christ. Now, on what is clearly the most significant, important decision that a human being can ever make on this planet, more important than who you marry, more important than whether you have kids, more important than taking a job or where you live or whatever, is, am I going to trust Jesus Christ as my Savior, yes or no? That's not something that's just rushed into quickly and lightly. Jesus said there are people who have those great emotional experiences. Their life is so messed up, and someone's like, well, you know, Jesus will fix your life. Ooh, I want my life fixed up, and they're all focused still on self. Not coming to God as a guilty sinner, realizing, you mean my sins can be forgiven? You mean all the horrible things I've done, either to myself or to other people, can be forgiven by God? Yes. What do I have to do to get that? Just believe. We come to Christ as guilty saviors, or we're not coming the right way. So obviously, there's a process there. There's a process of belief that happens in our lives. And maybe some of you are going through that process even now, still trying to understand the claims of Jesus Christ. Your mind has been a little bit poisoned, if you will, by some of the examples you've seen in the world out there in the name of Jesus, some of the stuff that's been done or said or the behaviors and so forth. That's why we stick to the Bible and God's Word. But just understand that as long as we're on that search, and how important it is, but recognize that even in the process of the search, you're still in the camp of the rabid atheist in Jesus' sight, because you're either with him or against him. There's no neutrality. And that's why the Bible emphasizes this as well. Now is the time of salvation. Now is the day to call on the name of the Lord. Not just for fear that, you know, you might get hit by a car tomorrow and die, although that fear is legit. It could happen. It's minimal for most people. But you know death's coming. But how much more than just that? But to recognize what we were created for, a life with God who loves us, who's all-knowing and all-powerful, but also all-loving and kind and gracious and good. And he wants to use us in his world that he created. He wants to use us in the lives of others. He wants to bless us. He wants to do so much for us. But nothing is done until we have our sins forgiven. And then having our sins forgiven, we now have that new identity, and now we can go forth in newness of life for the reason that you were born on this earth. You know the meaning and purpose of your physical birth by having the spiritual birth. And so, my urging for any here, watching online, listening in some way to this message, if you have not personally trusted Christ as your Savior, not piggybacking on your parents or grandparents, not any such thing, personally said, Jesus, save me, then today's the day to do so. You've heard the gospel of your salvation. I've said it over and over again. He died for your sins, and he rose from the dead. He died as a sacrifice, a perfect sacrifice. He knew no sin, but he became sin for you and me so that we could become the righteousness of God in him. Trust him today and start that newness of life. For the rest of us who know the Lord, we continue on studying this chapter to understand how we can get those victories that we seek in our lives to live for him and to please him and to live righteous lives that God would have us do. Keep coming back. Lord, thank you for this time in your word. We pray your blessing as we go forth now. May we hear your voice throughout this week, and may we yield ourselves to the Spirit's promptings, his commands, his wisdom, all things, Lord. We pray that we would say, not our wills, but your will be done, day by day, decision by decision, moment by moment, to the glory of our precious Savior Jesus, in whose name we pray. Amen.